It is useful to understand the difference between a Cook reduction and a Karp reduction. A Cook reduction reflects what we intuitively do when we write a program to solve some problem X, and we can use some sub-procedure that already exists for solving some problem Y. We assume that this sub-procedure can answer a query within a single computational step. So in a single computational step, it can answer whether some word is contained in a language or not. Karp reductions are much more restrictive. You can think of a Karp reduction in the following way. A Karp reduction is a Cook reduction, but you can only call the oracle once, and you can only do so at the very end, and then whatever your answer is has to be exactly the same as the answer that you got from the oracle. So if the oracle responds with yes, then you have to return yes in your program as well. And if the oracle responds with no, then in your program you also have to return no. A Karp reduction is a special form of a Cook reduction. So every Karp reduction is a Cook reduction, but not every Cook reduction is a Karp reduction. Karp reductions and Cook reductions are good for different things. Cook reductions maybe more intuitively reflect how we would program. They are very useful when we are dealing with undecidability, so we can use them to establish that problems are undecidable. And also observe that Cook reductions can deal with computational problems which are not decision problems. Karp reductions, on the other hand, can only deal with decision problems. They are defined in such a way that it only makes sense if both of the problems, the problem you're reducing from and the problem you're reducing to, are decision problems. And they are more restrictive. This can be a good thing. It's good if we want to explore a more rich complexity landscape. This will be difficult to understand right now, but very roughly speaking, Cook reductions can sometimes sort of mush together different complexity classes which we would prefer to keep separate. So that's the reason why we sometimes prefer to use Karp reductions. And also, when we use Karp reductions, certain arguments that we will make later on become somewhat simpler. There are textbooks that use Cook reductions instead of Karp reductions in all situations, but I will not do this here. I will keep Karp reductions and Cook reductions as two separate concepts that are used in different circumstances. So, to summarize, Cook reductions can call an oracle multiple times, can then further process the answers from the oracle, and can handle non-decision problems. They are in particular used to prove undecidability for problems, and later on we will also use them to do something like self-reducibility, which will basically mean that we can establish that a search problem is of similar difficulty as the corresponding decision problems. But this will become more clear later. Karp reductions can call the oracle only once. They cannot further process the answer from the oracle. Instead, they need to just take the answer from the oracle, and that is the answer that's given. And they cannot handle problems which are non-decision problems. They can only deal with decision problems or languages. In particular, we will use Karp reductions when we want to compare languages to one another, especially when we look at the time complexity of those languages.